giving the presentation on Falcon's Swift server last month. So before I go ahead about scripting in Swift, I want to ask you a question. How many of you are a Swift developer here? Almost all of them. Some of them didn't raise their hand. And how many have you done scripting in Swift? Okay, so it may be an interesting talk for you guys. Alright. So consider a scenario. Why do you need to do scripting in Swift? Alright. So I work for Property Guru. By the way, there is my colleague from Property Guru. Yeah, so consider a scenario. In Property Guru, we have a project and we have 4 different countries. And for each country, we have 4 different apps. It's not actually the same app and localized for different countries. It's rather a different app for different countries, even though we have the same project. So we had this situation where we had one project, and then we had 4 different targets. And for each country, we had its own configuration file, which was a Phoenix file, right? And every time we wanted to do some kind of update, you had to update in 4 different configuration files. So you wanted to add some keys and then some values, you have to go find for this country, that country, and do it for 4 places, right? So very hectic. That's horrible, right? just for one simple change, you are going changing 4 different configuration files. So do you have solution? Yeah. So how about just simple solution, right? The easy one. Let's merge everything together. Merge all the config files into one single config file. And then figure out something from there. So it would look something like this. So the left hand side, right, we have some examples. So for target one, you have some menu area and then that bunch of items. So this was the earlier version. You have 4 different config files. Now you combine them together and then make it a single config file. So you can write different configuration for different targets. And in case they were sharing the same thing, you could probably write one default case for all of them and you could solve the problem. But there was a big problem here. It's not feasible. There were more than 1,000 keys, right? So manually updating, and nobody got time for that, right? Too much. So we thought about, so we have to somehow automate this thing. So automate means combining these 4 config files into one file. So how do we do? So we thought, okay, let's write a script file. Well, actually, we have a lot of scripting in our project. A lot of them were being written in Python and Shell and other things. So it's about, okay, we have Swift. Why don't we try to do it in Swift? And then we ended up doing it, and it was pretty cool. So that was just a scenario why actually we should be interested as a iOS developer in trying the scripting in Swift. It's pretty cool. First of all, it's a very familiar language. Even though most of you are probably very familiar with Shell or Python, right? But writing scripting in Swift is pretty cool. You can use a lot of familiar things already. And I'll give you another scenario where we can actually use scripting. For example, the first case, you have a finished file, and then you want to generate the keys. Instead of typing those single keys like in the quotations, you can just create the enum keys for the finished, right? So you write a scripting file, and before the project is built, you run this scripting file, and then it will automatically generate it for that. Similarly, for the image assets, you can write your own Swift linter. You want to have a rule like, so say your file is too long, more than 400 lines. That's too much, right? We don't want our file to be too long. Maybe 200, 250 maximum. So you want to throw warning or error depending on the length of the file, or some kind of rule depending on your company thing. You can define those using the Swift scripting as well. And some people have seen, they write the localized strings instead of reading from the localized bundle. They read from the cloud, and then they have their own way of kind of automatically reading those strings from your project and then putting them inside the localized bundle and then reading them from the cloud. Alright, that's the setup. So if you haven't used it before, the way to write the way to start writing script. Of course, you can just open a normal file, call it a script. Just like a shell, you can import the user bin script and then start writing it there. If you are working with Xcode, then the way to do is open it, new project in Nightware in command line 2. This will give you this one. Create a simple folder and give you a right. So okay. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about. So you can write your own stuff. That's the normal way. How about if you wanna import third-party framework or third-party libraries? For that, there is a way. You need to just generate the framework or the library. And to generate the framework, you have some tools here. Of course, you can generate from the cartridge, right? Everybody uses cartridge. This CocoaPods came up with their own called CocoaPods Home. By the way, the TunicWars is you can search the file between Rome and Carthage. Back in history, the name Carthage and Rome, so there is some history behind that. And then, of course, using Swift Package Manager. So the key is just to, if you want to use third-party library in your scripting, you just need to you create the framework and then you have to put something at the top to show it. So in this example, I'm using a framework called SwiftLang, right? So this framework is pretty useful for writing some colorful output in the console. So the framework is located at the Rome folder. So by putting that framework inside the Rome folder and writing that line at the top, now I can import SwiftLang in my command line Swift file. So before I go to a simple demo, I'll just show you guys some cool command line libraries available in GitHub and pretty cool one. I recommend everybody to go and check. The SwiftLang that I just talked, it has some nice tools for you to write colorful output, also some helper like run, ask, a lot of cool helpful. And command line, commander, I think a lot of them do the same thing. My favorite is SwiftLang, but I recommend other people to go back and check them out. Alright, so yeah, that's for the talk. Now I'll just do a quick demo just to show you guys how to use. I'll just start from the Xcode code. So we wanna use the script from the command line, right? So I need to write something here at the top to tell that it is using Swift. So let's go ahead and run this one. What happens, right? The reason I couldn't do that was it's not yet executable yet. So I can run it like this, demo script main. Sorry. Yeah. Here's another try. Okay, anyway, so I converted into an executable file. So this symbol, there's nothing right now, just say print hello world, right? Alright, so the demo tray I'm going to show you is, I'm going to show you just how to use a script at the beginning and then how to call, like say, some other command lines from within the script code. So the demo I'm going to show you is, there's an API. The API will give you the, say, the Olympic medal list, and then if you give a country name, it will give you the number of gold medals, those medals won by that country. Right, so I have some helper snippets here. So this is a medal struct here. So position, country, gold count, silver count, all those things. I have some helper methods to print things, so there is nothing here, nothing to explain, pretty simple stuff. Alright, I'll go through these, I'm not going to type everything at least. Something might go wrong. So, alright, I'll explain about this function over here. This run command. So this helps me, if I pass something into this function run command, it will use the system bounce path user bin environment and then run these arguments. This class process used to be called nstask in the earlier version of Swift. And then later they named to task, and then the latest version of the Swift is called process. And then the class that used to be called process is now called command line. So don't get confused with that one. This process means actually get nstask. So what I'm doing here is I'm launching the nstask using the arguments that we are passing in the function. And then the output of the result of the command, like for example, if you say git status, it is going to output something, right? I'm going to put the output inside the output here. It's a data. So that's what it is doing. So there is the main part. Alright. What it does here is there is two functions here. Let's focus on the first one, get medals. So if you pass, like say 10, 15, it will just give you the top 10, top 5 countries with the medal in the Olympics, right? So there is this API called medal board, which gives you the things. So I'm here, I'm calling the call command line from this function. Run command call and then minus s is to silence the verbose. I'm getting the output as a data using the method of here, this run command, right? So it will take some time get the output from the API, and then the output is available in the output there. And then I'm using the JSON parser, converting those things into medals, and then I'm printing the medals out. So I want to run this thing now. All right. So I have this method called read input. So like I said, the method that used to, the class that used to be called process is now called command line. Command line, and then the arguments are the arguments that you are passing in the command line thing, right? So it is checking the arguments that you have passed. If there are more than one argument, and then it checks if it's a country or if it's a count, and then it will call one of those APIs and then give you the result. Pretty simple. And then this is the main thing called read input. So these all are definition. And then the beginning, the only thing that this main function, main.swift is doing is calling this read input function, which reads the user arguments and then prints out the result. All right, so we should be okay now. So let's go do this. So let's say 3. So it's committing. Okay. All right. So it gave me the top 3 countries. And then printed out the mail count for those countries. And let's do another one. Let's say Singapore. Alright, so 54th, one gold medal. Right, so yeah, just wanted to do a simple demo, nothing fancy here. Can go one more time. Just a device like I'm getting the arguments from the command line arguments, using it to get the country or the count, and then I'm using the main function called run command, which is just passing the arguments inside, and then calling the next task, which is called now called process, putting the output into data. The thing, the key is, I don't want, if you don't put this like, put the output inside data, it will print everything outside inside the console. So when you call the call method from here, from inside this file, it will give you some statistics and then the content of this, right? So you won't see it because you are putting the output here. Yeah, and that's it. That's the whole demo. Thanks. If you have any questions, please ask.
Hi.
Yes.
How fast is it? Like, did you benchmark it against like other languages and, you know, what happens when you have a lot of data?
The first time is slow, but somehow the second time onwards it will become very fast. I haven't benchmarked it, but having used it in our project, you don't feel it. It's pretty fast.
How do you debug with breakpoints if you do?
Actually, you can debug. You can run this thing inside the Xcode project itself, right? So here you can debug. If you not run from the command line outside, from the terminal, you just do it from here, I think you can put the breakpoint here and then debug it like this.
But then you have to pass arguments.
You can do it, right? Standard. You can set the environment here,
yeah.
Somewhere, the scheme, and then
yeah.
Put some arguments, whatever you want to put. Uh-huh. Yeah, and then debug it.
Does the Xcode have like internal console or something like Eclipse,
if you're doing Java? Yeah, this is the internal console.
Oh, okay,
that one,
okay.
Yeah, so let me finish this. You see the result here also, see?
Okay.
So by default, it prints all the countries that are in the middle, right? So you see all of them here. So, yeah. Any other? Okay, thanks very much.